is Tim Quatman, and he's going to talk about the Markov automata with multiple objectives. Just a second.
Good, yeah, thank you. Yeah, this is joint work with Sebastian Junges and Jus-Peter Gatun, all from Aachen. And I would like to start the talk with some example to motivate what we are doing. Consider a stochastic job scheduling problem where we are given n jobs on the one side and k identical processors on the other side, and our task is to schedule these jobs on the processors. The stochastic part is that we assume that the service times of the individual jobs is exponentially distributed with some rate lambda. So this means that jobs with a low rate, statistically speaking, probably require a longer time than jobs with a high rate. Good. Now the task is to find a good schedule, but to do this, we first want to know which objective we want to achieve for this system. And we consider in this talk these two objectives. At first, we would like to minimize the expected time to complete all these jobs. And secondly, we also want to maximize the probability to complete n jobs within an hour, for example. And again, the question, what's the best strategy to achieve these objectives? And we can show that for the first objective, if we just have a look, if we just focus on the first objective, then it's the best thing to do is to do the statistically slowest jobs first, because this avoids situations where we have, for example, just one very long job left, which can only be executed on a single processor, and the other processors are idling. So for the first objective, it's the best thing to do the slowest jobs first, but this is obviously not so good for the second objective, because this will certainly not maximize the probability to do n jobs already within 1 hour. So for the second objective, it's the best thing to do the fastest jobs first. The bottom line is that there is not the best strategy to achieve all these objectives. There is some kind of trade-off. And multi-objective model checking aims to analyze these trade-offs. Here's a picture that we get from our algorithms for the job scheduling problem, where we have 12 jobs and three processors. And in this picture, we have the expected completion time on the x-axis, and the probability to do six jobs within 1 hour on the y-axis. And then one point in the green area means that these values are achievable. So this means that there is some schedule for these jobs under which the expected completion time is at least, or at most 2.8, and the probability to do six jobs in 1 hour is at least 0.5. So we can directly see from this picture that this is possible. And we can also see that if we are not satisfied with, for example, this probability, we can lift it up to 0.7, but this also means that we have to accept expected completion time of 2.9 time units instead of 2.8. So this means any point in this green area is achievable. We can find some schedule, and we also have this red area, which says these points are not achievable. And then there's some thin white area in between, which means that for this we don't know, so our algorithm gives us some approximation of this set of achievable points. There are already approaches for this, for Markov decision processes, and these approaches are based on multi-objective linear programming and value iteration. But MDPs are sometimes not expressive enough. For example, for our job scheduling problem where we had these continuous timing or these continuously distributed service times. And therefore, for this talk, we want to lift these ideas to make them also work for Markov automata. Markov automata are a very expressive modeling formalism that supports probabilistic branching and non-determinism in instantaneous time. And there's also a notion of continuous time, and I will come to this in a second. And yeah, this is expressive enough for our job scheduling problem, but there's also other application areas like stochastic Petri nets, dynamic fold trees, and also the AADL. Good. So let's have a closer look on this model. Here's an example Markov automaton. There are two types of transitions. First, there are probabilistic transitions which work as MDPs. So, for example, if we are at S1, then we pick some action, alpha or beta. And if we pick beta, then we will go to S2 with probability 0.7 and otherwise to S3. And these transitions happen instantaneously. And then there are also Markovian transitions which work as in continuous time Markov chains. So this means that we use these dashed arrows, and for example, this transition means that We go from S0 to S1 within t time units with probability 1 minus e to the minus 2t. So this can be used to model exponentially distributed delays. That's our model. The kind of properties that we consider are, at least for this talk, this is untime reachability. So what's the probability to reach a set of goal states? And then there's time reachability, which means the probability to reach a set of goal states within b time units. However, these probabilities are only defined if we have some notion that resolves the non-determinism in the model. And therefore, we have this so-called scheduler or strategy sigma, the notation which tells us in which situation we will pick which action. Good. Let's see an example multi-objective model checking query. We have here this rather simple model, which is in fact an MDP because there are no Markovian transitions. And on the other side, we have this multi-objective query, which says, I would like to find all these points P such that there's one scheduler sigma under which the probability to reach S1 is at least P1, and the probability to reach S2 is at least P2. So let's see what we can achieve in this example. First, consider this strategy, sigma 1, which always chooses alpha at this state. This leads us to S1 with probability 1, and we will never reach S2 with this scheduler. So therefore, this means that this point P equals 1,2 is achievable. And it's also depicted here in this plot. Good, let's consider another scheduler called sigma 2, and this one focuses more on the second objective. First, when we are at S0, we pick action beta. And then if we are lucky enough to go back to S0, we will then do action alpha. And this leads to the reachability probability for S2. This leads us to reaching S2 with probability 1, and S1 with probability 1/2. So therefore, the point 0.5,1 is achievable considering this scheduler. However, notice that this point is only achievable if we have some kind of memory for our schedulers. The scheduler needs to remember whether we are visiting S0 the first or the second time. And without this memory or history dependency, this would not be achievable. Good. Let's see. We also can consider we can also achieve all these points on the line between the two points we considered before. And this can be done by doing some randomization. So, for example, this scheduler basically flips a coin, and with probability 1/2, it does the same as sigma 1. And otherwise, it does the same as sigma 2. And this gives us the achievable point here directly in the middle. Good. So notice that this is only possible if your scheduler employs some notion of randomization. So we need, in general, we need history-dependent and randomized schedulers. Good. The final picture looks like this. We have the green area, which are the achievable points. For these points, we can find some scheduler under which the corresponding probabilities can be achieved. And otherwise, there's a red area where this is not possible. So again, this is nothing new. Because this is only an MDP, there are already approaches that do this. So now let's try to lift this to Markov automata. Here, the idea is to consider the underlying MDP of the Markov automata, because this abstracts away from all the timing information. The underlying MDP is obtained by basically rescaling the exit rates such that they become probabilities. So that they sum up to 1. And one can show that this preserves transition probabilities in the sense that taking this transition from S2 to S1 has the same probability as taking this one. Again, this abstracts away from all the timing information, and therefore, as long as we're only considering untimed reachability objectives, this should preserve our multi-objective query. However, there is one thing to notice here. The objectives on this side might be achievable with some scheduler that employs the timing information. For example, a scheduler that says, yeah, I pick alpha if and only if I stayed 3 time units in S0. And such a scheduler cannot directly be applied to the right side, so to the underlying MDP, because there is no notion of timing. So therefore, it might be the case that, due to this problem, we might have the case that objectives are achievable here with the time scheduler, but not on this side. However, in the paper, we showed that this cannot be the case, and the solution was to transform the time scheduler, the scheduler sigma that possibly employs the timing information, to a time abstract scheduler denoted by TA of sigma. The idea is that TA of sigma randomly guesses the choices of the original scheduler sigma, and this random guess can be based on the time abstract history that is observed. Good. For example, if we have the original schedule saying choose alpha if and only if we stay three time units in S0, then TA of sigma would choose alpha if and only with the probability to stay three time units in S0. So time information is simulated by probabilistic guesses. Good. This leads us to the following proposition. It basically says that untime reachability is preserved under the underlying MDP. So if the probability to reach G in the Markov automaton under sigma is the same as the probability to reach G in the underlying MDP under TA of sigma. This can be lifted to multiple objectives, which leads us to this following theorem. I use psi of p to abbreviate this multi-objective query considering untimed reachability. And we have that if p is achievable in the Markov automaton, then p is also achievable in the underlying MDP. So therefore, we can do our multi-objective analysis on the underlying MDP instead of the Markov automaton. Good. And in the paper, we also showed similar results for expected reward objectives or expected time objectives, which consider some expected value of a certain measure. More details can be found in the paper. Now let's switch to time reachability. And this one is a little bit more involved because now here we have an example with the time reachability probability. So we want to reach S4 within two time units. And now we can observe that timing information becomes crucial for optimal schedulers. And to observe this, let's consider, for example, a scheduler that reaches S1 after three time units, so S3, which is greater than two. And then in this situation, it doesn't make sense at all to play action better because we don't get anything if we reach S4 when the time bound has already passed. So the optimal schedulers need to employ somehow the timing information. And in more details for this example, we get that for any t between 0 and 2, an optimal scheduler is a scheduler that chooses alpha if and only if we state at least t time units in S0. We can observe that this is the picture from this multi-objective query, and we see that the set of achievable points has infinitely many vertices, so which makes the whole thing a little bit more harder to compute because computing exact computations of infinite polytopes is a little bit more involved, I would say. So therefore, we are doing an approximative method, which employs a digitization approach. Instead of considering the underlying MDP as before, we are now considering a digitized version of the Markov automaton, which has self-loops at each Markovian state with the probability to stay at the corresponding state for delta time units. Here, delta is some digitization constant that we can fix up front, and this constant will later control the accuracy of our approximation. So the approximation works in the sense that we can here count the number of self-loops taken, and this gives us then a digitized estimate of the actual sojourn times on this side. Therefore, we are considering the digitization step bounded reachability probabilities. So this is the probability to reach a set of goal states within k digitization steps. For this, we have shown in the paper that this gives us a lower bound for the time reachability probabilities. So reaching G within K steps is a lower bound, the probability to reach G in K steps is a lower bound for reaching G within B time. However, one ingredient is missing. Again, we cannot simply apply this time scheduler for the Markov automaton also for the digitization. So therefore, we also digitize the schedulers, which means that it uses, again, randomization to guess these choices of the original scheduler sigma. And this randomization can be based on the observed time digitized history. We also get an upper bound. So this is the lower bound. We also get the upper bound, which considers the same probability plus some epsilon, where epsilon is a constant that depends on the Markov automaton and K and delta. Good, so this gives us, for a single objective, some low and upper bounds for the time reachability. This can be lifted to multiple objectives, leading to the following theorem. It says if we are considering some conjunction of time reachability probabilities, then if the point P is achievable in the digitization, it also has to be achievable in the Markov automaton. Or as a picture, if we have given that these are the achievable points in the digitization, then, for example, this point, according to the theorem, has also be achievable in the Markov automaton. Therefore, this is our under-approximation of the set of achievable points. And on the other side, there's the second part of the theorem, which says if a point is achievable in the Markov automaton, then P minus epsilon has to be achievable in the digitization, and therefore, if you assume for a second that this one would be achievable in the Markov automaton, then according to the theorem, this one has to be achievable in M delta, but as this is not the case, we can conclude that this point is not achievable, and similarly, we can argue for any point in this red area. So this is our approximation of the set of achievable points. So any point in the green area is achievable in the Markov automaton, any point in the red area is not, and in the white area we don't know. So the actual set might look like this one, the blue one. Note that these are overlapping with the green set. This one is overlapping with the green set. And in order to make a finer approximation, we can choose a small digitization constant, which might lead us to, for example, this picture. Good. Some experiments. I will have to go through this rather quickly. First, how do we compute the achievable points in the underlying NDP and also in the digitized Markov automaton? This is done by doing some variants of your favorite multi-objective NDP algorithms. So therefore, there already exist methods to do this. And we implemented the whole thing in our new model checker Storm, which will be presented on Friday. And the implementation computes over epsilon approximations of the set of achievable points. Here are some results for multi-objective MDPs, where we can compare our implementation with the implementation in PRISM. And we observed that the two implementations are competitive with each other. Good. So this was on multi-objective MDPs. But this talk is about Markov automaton, and here I'll give you some results for a Markov automaton for our job scheduling problem that I've discussed initially. We have n jobs and k processors, and here this table shows in the first line the different combinations of objectives that we have considered. So in the first entry of each tuple, we have the number of untimed reachability objectives, then the number of expected reward objectives, and last, finally, the number of timed reachability objectives. In the subsequent rows, we see the different instances for the job scheduling problem. And then for each combination of instance and objectives, we have the number of vertices of the approximation, also of the achievable points. So this gives us some indication of how complicated this trade-off is, and also how complicated it is to compute these trade-offs, this picture, but only the rough indication. Then there's also the running time, how long did our implementation require to compute the approximation. What we see, the timeout, by the way, refers to the fact that the computation time exceeded 2 hours. What we see is that we were able to compute rather large instances. For example, here we have successfully computed the achievable points for a model with 4.6 million states, and also 4 objectives are considered. But notice that this does not consider any timed reachability objective, so this can be done on the underlying MDP, which can be analyzed rather efficiently. But as one can also observe in single objective Markov automata analysis, timed reachability is rather hard to compute. So here we see, we can compare one instance without timed reachability, which was where we were able to compute this rather fast. And as soon as time reachability is involved, the running time increases drastically. This is even more apparent if we increase the precision. Before, we considered 0.01, and here now we have 0.001, and there are way more timeouts, and this is partly due to the fact that the number of points of the achievable points increases, so it's more complicated to compute, but also, so there are more iterations needed, basically, in our algorithm, but also each iteration takes longer because we have to choose smaller digitization constants. There are more experiments of this in the paper, also for other case studies, not only the job scheduling problem. So now let's conclude what we have seen. We have discussed multi-objective model checking for Markov automata. And the main idea was to reduce this to multi-objective MDP model checking. And this can be done by considering the underlying MDP for untimed reachability and expected reward objectives. And we can consider the digitized version of the Markov automaton for timed reachability. Experiments have shown that this is indeed applicable for practical benchmarks, even if you have 4 objectives, which is already considered as many objectives in some multi-objective literature. Good. For the future, we plan to apply our algorithms to, for example, generalized stochastic page nets. So we want to make use of this broad application area of Markov automata. And on the other side, I've only talked about how which values can be achieved, so but not how these values can be achieved. So what is now our actual job schedule? And this is not part of this research, but this is all part for future work. So we want to synthesize some kind of scheduler. Good. So that's it. Thank you for your attention.
Perhaps one quick question. Can you use the mic?
So what is the relationship between epsilon and k? Is it...
Sorry, no.
What is the epsilon... what is the relationship between epsilon and k?
The difference between epsilon and k?
Yeah.
K is basically the number of Markovian transitions we can take until reaching the goal state, and epsilon is some constant with some weird term. I didn't want to put it on the slides. It depends on the model, the maximum rate in the model, and also on the step on k, and also on the digitalization constant. Basically the same. I'm not sure if you're familiar with single objective Markov automata paper, but it's the same as we have in single objective.
So is it reciprocal to k? Say.
What is? Sorry.
Is it reciprocal to k?
Restrictable to k?
Is it reciprocal to k?
Oh, sorry.
Okay. Reciprocal.
Is it proportional to the inverse of k?
I think it's somewhat in the exponent of this term, so it's not in the inverse.
Oh, okay.
Ah, yeah, sorry.